out of state, so her spirit is here, and she fully intended to be here, but she's handed off the baton to us, and so what we're going to do here is very quickly go around, and if you would introduce yourselves, other than the bureau team, introduce yourselves and maybe stand up and do that and let us know who you work for, but don't give us your life story and why you're here. You're going to get a chance. We're going to never want to listen. But we found it. If we can know who's in the room, I think that helps us. So with that, have a gentleman with the bow tie, please stand. Well, come on. That's you don't need to be here. Yeah, come on, stand up.
Good afternoon. Eric Knowles, president of the Miami-Dade Chamber, board member of the Greater Miami Convention and Visitors Bureau.
All right.
Good evening, Keon Williams, assistant director of Urban Philanthropies, and also the Urban, which is the name of the town.
All right. Okay.
You're
going
to
get
to
come.
Yvette Harris, Harris Public Relations.
Good evening, everyone. Rosie Lloyd Wallace, Santa Black, Miami.
Hi, everybody. My name is Margie, and I represent Chad. We are the Cultural Heritage Alliance for Tourism.
We know Chad. Live. Here we go.
Nicole Gates, I'm the president and CEO of Overtown Media and a managing partner of Lil Greenhouse Grill and Good Red Alley Sophisticated.
Somebody new here? Somebody snuck in? Okay.
Hi everyone, my name is Tiffany Ortiz. I work for Stephanie Creates as a community aid.
Thank you.
Hello, good evening everyone. My name is Judy Barmer. I'm the founder of a nonprofit organization, the Iron Bar Group, where we work with young people in the performing arts to just give them a platform to display their talents and empower, encourage, and motivate them within the inner city community. And we've been established for some time now, since 94. Thank you.
You have 2 minutes, sir.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ayo Salvador. I'm from Lagos, Nigeria. I've been living in Miami for 15 years. And about 3 years ago, I started a tourism company. The interest of the company is to let everyone know to take advantage of doing business in Nigeria. That's the largest country we have in Africa. Almost about 70 million people. And the money is going to be very, very worth it. Making it happen next week, actually by the end of April. So whoever are interested in going to Africa for the first time, you see the light are standing here with very small money. It's a pleasure to be here.
3 minutes.
Good evening, Selena Nelson with Virgin.
Here, let's hear it for that.
Good evening, Alex Eaton with Gallagher North Cameron. We have the best conference in Midtown.
All right.
Good evening, Gal Sutherland.
Karen Harden? No.
Good evening, my name is Martin Stalwart, the Office of Commissioner Keno Harden, City of Miami.
Let's hear it for
Good evening, everyone. My name is Joanna Whiteley, co-founder of the Golden Strokes Collective, and we aim to use visual arts to empower the community.
Hi, I'm Robbie Bell. People think I sell real estate. In reality, I sell the South Florida lifestyle magic.
Okay. Okay, Robbie!
Good evening, I'm Kimberly
Forson, and I'm a social science teacher in Miami Dade County Public Schools.
Good evening, I'm Karen Warren from Miami, and I work with New Synergies Consulting, and we work on expanding and enhancing community, economic, and cultural assets.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Naomi St. Holland. I'm an area sales executive with Marriott International Hotels.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Lily Lopez. I'm with the area sales team at Marriott International, representing the Miami Marriott Business Bank.
I'm Taylor Robinson, and I'm representing Rocky Bank.
Nemo Williams, Nemo Luau, and Pokemon Friday.
Jerome Hutchison, I copy.
Peter Bailey, I copy you.
I'm getting tall. Stand up again, please.
Joe Louis Saint, my voice, I'm sorry. Joe Louis Saint, Show Technology, Audiovisual Production Company.
Good evening, Diane Ewing, Show Technologies, Audiovisual Production Company.
You don't know?
My name is Andy Ingram. I'm the president of the National Association of Black Hotel Owners, Operators, and Developers. And we just opened a new 65-room hotel 3 blocks away from here called the New Manhattan Hilton Lifestyle Curio Collection.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Sandy Dorsonville. I'm the executive producer for Sounds of the Living. All right.
Lady who needs no introduction, please stand up, please. Caroline and I have been together, what, 35 years? 35 or more years, we're just starting, right? We've been along, but Caroline Taylor is a mother, a father, a grandmother, and the grandfather of the multicultural programs, been on the board of the Greater Miami Commission this year, I think before it was formed. So introduce yourself, Caroline.
Caroline Taylor Miami to go, but I actually work for the Greater Miami.
Derek Cole, photographer.
Xavier Charles with Cool Casual Entertainment.
Arisha Randolph with Sweet Butter Hospitality Group, One East Kitchen.
Sean Alicia Randolph, CEO of Shopping and Java Restaurant, and the Sweet Butter Hospitality Group.
All right, Sean.
Good evening, everyone. Melanie Flaherty, I'm a culinary arts teacher at Booker T. Washington Senior High School.
Reading about history, there's a number of folks have made history, but Dorothy Fields has saved it and written it. So Dorothy Fields, introduce yourself.
Good evening, Dr. Dorothy Jenkins Fields. How exciting it is to have you here and to have this in Overtown.
Started. Just roll along. We're going to make it happen.
She's so fired up.
How you guys doing? My name is Andre Soul Williams. I am the CEO of iUrban TV, representative of the Circle of Brotherhood, and the Business Development Council at the Overtown Business Resource Center.
Yes.
I'm also a legacy to the Overtown Oversight Advisory Board.
All right.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Fred McNair. I'm the sole person who takes care of the OPAC.
Okay.
And since the day the house is here, I am still part of the little thing.
Thank you, Brown.
Good evening to you all. My name is Charles C. Scott II. The director of outreach for Congressman Fredrique Wilson, Congressional District FL 24. Thank you so much for having
me. I can't match up. You want the party to start?
Yeah.
Dr. Field, you want the party to start? We've got here Connie Kennard. Are you in the house?
Hey!
Connie, stand up. Now, this is the time where I get to sit down, get quiet, and go in the back and enjoy it, and say I'm not going to say anything, but maybe sometimes I'm going to jump up. But our choir leader tonight is Connie Kennard, the Vice President of the Multicultural Tourism and Development Department of your Greater Miami Convention and Visitor Bureau. So take it away, Connie.
Thank you. And really, I'm going to make it quick because we have a lot of great engagement to get to. But first, I just want to thank you for being here. It makes a difference. A lot of you we've partnered with in some form or fashion. A lot of you we've reached out to specifically to come. You got emails from probably Petra, from myself, and you're here tonight. And your voice matters. As we were talking about earlier, we had a focus group before this meeting. A lot of the information that was shared, I guess 5 years or before this week's announcement, about 5 years ago, really is the reason, hopefully, that you've seen some of the things that we're doing progressing and taking multiculturalism and diversity to the next level. But those things happened because of a voice 5 years ago, right? And so now things are growing, Miami is growing, and your voice tonight will make a difference. And we just really appreciate you. And I just want to personally thank you, Neil. I'll be 4 years here as of June 1st, and really many of you in this room I'll just have to say, many of you in this room have been just supporters from business level and even from a personal level, and it really means a lot. Thank our committee chair, Carolyn Taylor. Thank Dr. Dorothy Fields, who's been a supporter. Of course, our full board of directors, Eric here, just the whole community, because the saying that it takes a village is the truth, and we know that it takes a village in order to move forward. The last thing I want to say is that I think we will have a total of 15 of these strategic sessions before it's over. You are here tonight in Overtown. We're grateful. We're going to have some great dialogue. But a personal request is that you tell your friends, you tell other businesses, folks that look like you as well, to also participate in some of the other forums, all right? Because tonight is a diverse night, but we want to make sure that every forum that happens has diversity and that it's a main forefront during these discussions. So if you can spread the word, I personally would appreciate it. We all would. So thank you. Rolando?
Thank you, Connie. So folks, let's give Connie a hand. She's an amazing member. And I remember clearly when she entered our offices almost 4 years ago, she made a lot of friends because she brought those amazing Google clusters from back home. So those made quite an impression. And as Bill said, she's been an amazing choir leader, and I think it's appropriate. We're here in the historic OPAC. Used to be Ebenezer Methodist Church, so I think this is one of the great venues of what is becoming one of the most exciting parts of our community. Downtown Miami, Overtown, Little Havana, these cultural neighborhoods which have been at the forefront of our multicultural marketing efforts, thanks to not only Bill's leadership, Carol Ann Taylor. I'm Rolando Aieto. I've been with the Convention and Visitors Bureau for more than 20 years, so I've kind of grown up in the Convention and Visitors Bureau, working closely with Bill, and of course, Meredith Sterling before then. I have a dual role at the Convention and Visitors Bureau. I'm the Chief Operating Officer. I also serve as the de facto Chief Marketing Officer. And I have the privilege of not only doing what I do, but there's an amazing team of marketers and sales folks. A lot of them are in the room. And they're at your disposal. Any questions that you may have on a variety of things that we do on behalf of the community, That's why they're here for us. You probably have about 15 team members, head of PR, head of marketing, social media, sales. They're in the room and they will be available as resources not only during the session, but any questions after that. We're scheduled to go on until about 8 o'clock. In a moment, I'll turn it over to our facilitators. And before I do that, Connie alluded to the fact that we do this every 5 or 6 years. And this process is so, so important because we're building the roadmap for this community's number one industry for the next 5 years or so. When we did this last time, there was a couple of key priority items that were identified as growth opportunities. One of them I'll put down on the top of the list was multicultural tourism. You know, we've been celebrating our community's diversity for many, many years, but there was an opportunity to do even more. And we've been doing more. And part of that was establishing our multicultural tourism department and led by Connie with the support of many others. The other thing that was part of that important list was finalizing our convention center renovation. And that happened. We just opened up our new convention center, which creates an amazing opportunity for us to bring in more businesses to this community, more meetings, more conventions. And just a few months ago, they approved a new headquarter hotel right next to it. So hopefully that will break ground soon. So those were just two of the key things that came out of the last effort. It called for expanded international marketing. We've done that as well. It called for an expanded digital marketing effort. And without getting into too many of the details of the last plan, I didn't want to share that with you because this plan doesn't just sit on the shelf and gather dust. This roadmap that you're helping build with us tonight will become a living, breathing document that will serve as the foundation as we develop our marketing plans year over year with a lot of input. So, really important process, and I think it's only appropriate that we're here in this this amazing facility, former church, to inspire. Yeah, this is a very spiritual experience for all of us, so please feel free to contribute to that. So to help us develop this plan, as we did many years ago and as we did recently, we went through a very comprehensive, competitive, open RFP process to identify consultants that could help us do this. And we've done this every year. We assemble a committee. And again, Caroline, you mentioned that you work for us because I know you were on that committee and many, many others. But that's the way that we do this is at the convention and visitors group. Open, inclusive. We want people's opinion, and then we make informed decisions. And the decision we made this time, and it wasn't the same consultant that we used last time, was identifying a firm. Was that me? Hopefully not. Okay. So was identifying a vested REIT firm that could help facilitate not only a great town hall meeting. We've been doing a variety of activities, including the one earlier today across the street. Switch. Okay. So this process is many months in the making, and we won't be done for another several months. So the information, the feedback that comes out of today's discussion, the one across the street, the 14 other town hall meetings, we're doing a series of interviews and focus groups, will then all be built into this plan that you're helping create. So thank you for being part of that process. And as Bill said earlier, you're not going to hear too much more from Bill, myself, the Convention Visitors Bureau. We're here to hear from you. And the people that will allow us to hear from you and facilitate the session are the firm that we've hired to help us do that. And that is Intervistas. They have an amazing track record of doing this in destinations, not only across the country, but across the world. You'll be hearing from a variety of their key team members, but I'm going to start with the project manager, Sonia Murray. So Sonia, take it away.
Thanks, Milan. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. I know you don't have lots of time in your very busy days, so we really appreciate the time you're going to take with us tonight. So we are leading the strategic plan, as Rolando said, and there are many elements to that plan, which are outlined behind me. Many of you are familiar with strategic plans. They act as a guide. You might be saying to yourself, you know, why does my own do a strategic plan? It's a great destination. It is, right out of the gate. It's been a wonderful place to come for many, many years. But the world has changed a lot, and there's a lot of places for people to go that have a lot of fabulous offerings. And also, the type of visit has changed a lot. What visitors like, you know, even in the last couple of years have changed. It's a lot about experiences now. So the wonderful thing about Miami is that it offers so much, and there's a lot here that really could be played up, that is sort of underplayed. And so these town halls and the focus groups that we're going through are helping us to pull out the nuggets that are going to really drive us over the next 5 years. And what this plan is going to do is identify new opportunities to bring in new visitors, to expand the visitors, and also to help enhance the GMCBD's role in that. So without further delay, I'm going to pass this off to Michelle. She's going to talk a little bit more about some of our community engagement activities.
Good evening, everybody. There's so many faces I see in the audience, and I'm so excited because I know this discussion is going to be juicy. It's going to be really, really good. So let me just start off by letting you know what we are doing as it relates to stakeholder and community engagement activities. We are hosting 70 plus one-on-one interviews. Some of you, you've already had the interviews, and we have gathered some really good information. We're going to have two workshops, meetings, some of which have already happened, and we have a visioning workshop. 15 town hall meetings, you're number two in a series of 15. So we heard a lot of good information over out west in Hialeah yesterday. We know we're going to hear some great information today right here in Overtown. Four focus group sessions. Actually, I guess it was five because we had a special one today. Some of you were a part of that. Good content was received, and it can be added into that strategic plan to have a successful completion of it. And then we have some surveys and some destination next assessments, which I think Paul is going to tell you a little bit more about. So we're going to get started with the town hall discussion, and I just want to give you an idea of how it's going to go. We're going to have four key questions that are going to be centered around awareness and brand of Greater Miami, visitor experiences, quality of life for residents, and new initiatives for the GMCB. This will be input that you give. So we are not going to have any content that's off limits. We understand we're going to hear a lot of good stuff. We're going to start with the first question. We're going to take about 15 minutes per question. The first being, how can we and the tourism industry help create more awareness of this area among visitors? Now, as I said, we had a little pre-session. We got some good information. Even if we hear that again, we don't want to miss any of it. So who's going to start us off on the speed round? Yvette?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, we have a Brightline train, and I'm not sure what the outreach or the relationship has been with the community and Brightline. So that would be one of the ways that we can increase tourism from the residents that are coming from Fort Lauderdale and Palm Beach, and then when it continues to Orlando as well.
Next.
Okay. I'm going to give the
mic to you. Hi. We know GMCB is a great marketing machine, but in my experience, some of the marketing that's been done for Little Haiti specifically, it's usually in urban or magazines or publications of color. But I think if we want to increase the number of tourists that come to Little Haiti, we need to market Little Haiti in publications and in media that is not necessarily for people of color or for people locally.
Perfect, thank you. Mr. Noel.
I would say it's a leading destination in terms of cruise ships. We probably could do a better job of those folks who come in to Miami prior to sailing, as well as after they sail.
Thank you.
I think that marketing our neighborhoods, our heritage neighborhoods, with a specific brand to culture. And the definition of culture for me is the sight of the place, the smell of the place, or the food, and the music of the place. And that would define us as a heritage neighborhood that people could plan to visit.
And just to let everyone know, we have a scribe. All of your comments are being taken down, as well as this is being recorded.
First, before we do any of that, we have to change the narrative of what Overtown is. We need to get a more positive narrative of what Overtown is and what Overtown is.
think about Overtown and what goes on in Overtown before we bring in more people from outside.
Right, Robbie, you said you have
a lot. That's a very important statement. I was about to add something to that. The other part to this is signage. I run into people in Brooklyn who can't figure out how to get out of Brooklyn to get to the train to get to where they're going, let alone get the bright line. And I have trouble trying to figure out where the bright line is. But I know it's right around here somewhere, but exactly where, because we need directional things, things people can see and read and use.
On the tour and market, you know, we travel, all of us, each and every one of us travel. And we know that just very broad issue of cruise line bringing in people. We need to have our information where people enter. They enter at cruise lines and they enter at the airport. So the information about Lupane, about Virginia Key, about Elizabeth, it needs to be every place where they have advertisers for hotels and other things. Another thing, we don't utilize, I don't think we're adequately represented at our turnpike way stations. I stop there, I see a booklet about every alligator stop, every crocodile dive, you know, and nothing about what Miami has to offer other than shopping parties. And we need, that's another part of the narrative we need to talk about changing when we talk about why it's worthwhile coming.
If I may, one of the challenges you have, and what I think you rectify very readily, is by offering the multi-cultural aspects of what Fabian has been done so far. I'm exposed a lot to foreigners visiting South Florida, as well as Americans coming here. And one of the things that they all face with is, what is beyond that clear? What is the very African Americans? We are the other ethnic groups. We have 180 languages spoken in public schools. Most people come in here with a Spanish aspect of things. And I think the tourism of Europe as a whole needs to definitely mark itself for beyond just Latin flavor. There's a whole culture of history here from the Afro-American perspective. There's a Spanish history as well, a sort of Caribbean flavor, and Franco-American and the Haitian concepts. There's a huge Canadian history, in fact, in South Florida, especially in CBS, just north of here. And so when you have people coming before Al Gaza, for instance, and they ask me, what else is there beyond salsa and paella? And I have to direct them to certain parts of South Florida to find soul food and things of that kind. It's critical, because quite frankly, not everyone comes to South Florida looking to find a new aspect of South Florida, they want to find a cultural element. And you know, just now, it's a fully built code. About Brownsville and Liberty City. He cut his teeth in Brownsville. He knows what I'm talking about. But very seldom you hear in Brownsville any publications or candidates showing videos or in South Florida. We have elements here that truly need to be recognized. South Bay is agricultural aspects. These are the kind of people who want to find organic foods and things. We have organic food markets here, and there's exotic fruits. Those things that we definitely got a job to do before they arrive. Thank you so much.
Okay, good afternoon. The area I look at is the area of the tourists being a lot to come here. I remember just last week we had the Jazz in the Garden, a lot of people were here. And all we need to do is to ensure that they are secure. As a matter of fact, listening to Hot 25 this morning, some of the police are now on the spring break, and some of them have been attacked. At the beach, all we need to do is to do a lot of security. And then in African side, a lot of African love to be here. Where I come from, Lagos, it's just like Miami or New York. So we're going to be having a lot of exchange of programs, especially among the students. All we need to do, we need to give them good security and let them go around the town and see what the town looks like. Thank you.
Yes. As being a self-proclaimed mayor of Overtown, I do some everything. I didn't even tell you everything, but I think that one of the things that we need to do, especially amongst this area here, because Overtown is my area, we need to do events here that are intentional. But they don't need to be super duper grand, grandiose events, right? Big events.
They need to be small, intimate events at places like the Cold Space, which is Little Greenhouse Square. It needs to be intentional. And it needs to be, I notice whenever I go, when I moved into New Orleans, I've been to New Orleans. New Orleans is the bomb. And every place I went, I had an experience. And I was prompted to take pictures just because I was having an experience. Did I have an experience here? So we need to create that experience. One last thing I want to close with is that I was a part of a group called Plan Beats. And we used to do Wynwood before Wynwood was Wynwood. We did this big block party. I used to MC it. And I would have 200 people around because we would be doing dancing, breaking, and all that other good stuff. And Wynwood was not populated the way it is now. When I started my company, I heard a TV, we went down there, and we used to take pictures. And when we went and took pictures, other people asked us after we posted, where did you take that picture at? And so then they began to start taking pictures. And that's how Wynwood became Wynwood, simply because people just said, hey, this is where we take the pictures at. And they started doing the walks with the wine tasting, and people like to drink. I'm not drinking. But that's how it grew into what it is now, where they're selling properties there for millions of dollars. So we need to create that experience here in Overtown, and maybe if some of it is intentional, but also intimate, then it'll grow into something bigger.
I am a firm believer that if you give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day. If you teach him a fish, he'll eat for a lifetime. It is so important that we educate business owners on how to properly use the social media and apps and applications that apply to tourism. So the question is, how can we in the tourism industry help create more awareness? Then let's educate ourselves and the businesses on how to properly use Yelp, how to properly use Google, how to properly use TripAdvisor. It goes far beyond your personal Facebook or Instagram page. You're only reaching a certain group. And now if you notice, you're reaching even less of your group, depending on what your advertisement looks like. So what I would like to see is even the GMCB getting involved, the GMCBB getting involved with maybe offering workshops on how to properly utilize Yelp, how to properly utilize TripAdvisor, because there is a buying mechanism that takes place that will fit within your budget, that teaches you how to strategically pick the demographics that you need to target, and therefore you'll capture the audience that you want to capture. Because for those of us that travel, you know, I think when we have our businesses, we forget how we use travel applications. If you just use it the same way and apply it to your business, I believe that you'll see more people through the door. But workshops on how to properly use these programs that offer also discounts on buying the advertising on these programs will be very helpful.
We talk about the rich history of Overtown, and from a local standpoint, we are all aware locally of the richness of this community in terms of history and how far it goes back into the days of, and I have to say, the Lyric Theater. We are aware of all of those things. We also boast about multiculturalism here in Miami, and I'm speaking as a native, as someone who was raised, grew up in Miami, saw the changes, and now doing my part, the small part that I can do. But with this, I want to take advantage of this opportunity to say how we boast about multiculturalism. We have a very diverse community. We're very aware of that. And each community has its own history. We're aware of that. We also are aware of some of the divisiveness between our communities. So I think this is a great opportunity as a collective effort, and I do see us an attempt to come together, but we can't have the riches and be promoting one community and not the other. And how can we have the richness here, but also we're where it takes economic development too. If they come here, where are those visitors, research Overtown, what attraction are they coming to see? With the hotel that's being built, trying to find Brightline, like the point that was made. So what we need to do, obviously our community have a responsibility to do our part to make sure that Brightline can be found, the hotel that's being built, the rich history. It's our responsibility, obviously, to create an attraction for them to come to. And then collectively, the collective effort economically stands with the tourism board and committee, as well
to bridge that gap when the funds come in economically that they are put into Wynnewood community and they're put into Overtown community so that Overtown can have something to share so that when people come in to visit, we have something attractive. And it's not just a conversation, but it's a collective effort. And the train is moving, and we are, and the party is beginning when the cameras are not on, when the cameras are off, when we all leave this room in December, we go back to our boards, and all the people who have the means to write a check for funding economically, to work with the Overtown committee so that we can build an attraction. And one idea that I think would be great and effective and wonderful is to build on the rich history of Harlem, because we know that the African-American influence is very, we all have wonderful influence on every community. That's not to take away, we know that. Just like we can publicly say that Miami is known now for salsa, why? Because people were proud of their rich history. So when we can publicly say, in Overtown, we're proud of the soul, we're proud of the jazz, we're proud of the voices and the dances and the culture, and we should not be judged in some type of way because of that pride. And we should be able to write to economically and fair prices, input or disperse the funds for this community to help build that effort, and then collectively bind the fabrics together that divide us, and then I can see change in this community that I can sit down and be proud of, and not just me, but our young people, because our young people see the vision, and we need to work on that level. I think change is coming, and it will be a stronger Miami, and people will be excited to come here, and we won't have the experiences of the spring break of what we see now, but they'll come dancing, they'll come proud, because each heritage or everyone has something. And don't just think that someone is just coming to see their culture, because we travel abroad so that we can see differences. So we want that same experience for Miami. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think
just 2 points. One, we, a couple months ago, late last year, we did the historic night out in Overtown, where that was a walking tour. It visited several of the restaurants. It was a space called Tribe. And it was about maybe 100 people attended that tour. I think more of those that are intentionally designed, I think there was like a budget set up. It was ran through Nootropic. So there's a lot of partners involved to have an intentional tour coming through here, stopping at the restaurants that are in the area, or even here, they even stopped here as well and had like a little party here. So those things I think are very important, and I know there's resources being allocated to do those types of things in certain neighborhoods. I think more of that is needed in this area here. And just somebody mentioned earlier about changing the narrative of Overtown. Just had an event Saturday, almost 4,000 people attended this event, not one single incident in Overtown. The City of Miami Police Department tweeted about this, as well as shared on Facebook, and how proud they were to be in Overtown. Not one single incident. It took over 4,000 college-age kids, spring breakers, who were coming down and wanted to have fun in Miami, and they did it here in the historic Overtown. So I just want to point that out as well.
That's right.
Hello, how you doing? Here you go.
Testing, 1, 2, 3. How you doing? My name is Keith Thackeray. I'm with Cultural Heritage Alliance Tours. Check. Also, from my standpoint of doing tours a lot here in Miami, is that the training of tour guides with other tour guide companies, training them on history of Miami, not just the Henry Flagler or the Junior Tunnel, but history, for example, dealing with Little Haiti. How important that the revolution in 1804 and in Little Haiti, when the French and the Portuguese were pushed out of Haiti, how that revolution in 1804 affected the United States with the, now that the French didn't have enough army power, how that ended up getting the second half, the other half of the United States with the Louisiana Purchase. Also, information for tour guides regarding what is called Fisher Island, used to be Dorsey Island. Okay, David Dorsey, first black millionaire in Miami. This is the type of history that is not being put out to people that are coming here to really give them an idea of what Miami is about. How the diversity has history here in Miami in the southeastern part of the United States, how it has affected the rest of the world. People come from French, Germany, all over the world. More training, more cultural training of tour guides and tour guide companies to be able to put this information out to the public that's coming in. So more diversified training for tour guides that are non-African American or non-black.
I was just thinking that there's an opportunity to combine like your local rewards or our loyalty rewards program with a social media program that can focus on spotlighting local businesses. So let's say for instance you did a Me in Miami campaign. So as people come off and you travel throughout Miami, you could have placards in a business where the person could take a picture of themselves in that business, promoting the business, promoting Miami, tie it into social media so that when they post it, as they get their likes, then you can give them some type of rewards. But that would spread and create, if you will, local flavor, focus, and businesses, people being here, having a good time.
That's a great idea.
So we're going to do question number two, and somebody's going to take that.
Thank you, Beth. Those were all really good comments. There's a lot of good energy and ideas in this room. Just as an aside, right before we came here, we had a focus group in a block away. It was about 15 to 18 small businesses that were either from Overtown or in the surrounding areas. And what we learned, really, is it doesn't seem like there's as much you guys need to create as to build awareness, because there is a lot here. So thank you for those comments. Question two, what are the best experiences for visitors in the surrounding area today? And what is missing or could be expanded? Nothing's missing?
Hi, everybody. My name is Margie, and I'm with Chat. And the question is, what are the best experiences for visitors in this surrounding areas? We're talking about Overtown. There's so much to showcase. There's so much that the community is willing to share, to collaborate, to be part of people that want to come and have the experience of like Overtown. You know, this is not like that. There's a lot of good things happening. Development is going on, you know, but the other part is, what is missing or could be expanded? The local business owners need to have the education, the resources, and the best part is to make them feel that they are the tourism that's happening here. It will not make a difference if we do not get those people involved, because then what we just have is just a structural building. And having people working for non-profit organizations to keep standing to make it happen. So it's not reinventing the wheel, it's not having that missing link and have everybody be part of that whole, and we all support each other, and we continue to grow and expand all the beautiful surrounding areas that Overtown has to offer for the locals and for those that want to visit and have that tangible experience to talk about it. Because that's the review that's going to show up for everybody. So we stick together and we make everybody as one, you know, we can make great things happen. And that, I think, the amazing part is that. Thank you.
So I would say easy access. What's missing? I'm a pedestrian, so I'm going to say easy access, because there is no easy access to the Overtown, specifically Overtown. You know, there's a child who is running somewhere. I don't believe it's running in here. Walkability. I wanted to park up the street, and when I go up the street, it's about 700 people with a blanket on the sidewalk right here around the corner. So I really honestly didn't want to park over there and walk back. So, you know, it's these little nuanced things. I know we can't move the homeless out of here, but that you have to be dealt with for people to feel like they can walk somewhere and go somewhere. A way to get here that doesn't require arm and leg, a taxi or what have you. So that's from that standpoint. Crossing the street, and people respect a pedestrian. We have the highest rate of deaths for pedestrians. So if they just wanted to walk from this thing to here, somebody might get hit. That's not a good thing. So that's it.
I'm going to piggyback on what Margie said, but I'm going to take it a step further. Access, and I think easier access to the funds that are supposed to be allocated for the businesses that are in this community. We should not have to jump through red tape. We should not have to, it should not be almost impossible for businesses that are already operating in this community to receive the funds they need to expand, to receive the funds they need to do proper advertising. It is really an insult when you are operating a business in a community and people get more excited about a business that has not even gotten here yet, hasn't even started, but yet you don't want to put in the time and the effort and the education and the funds, which, by the way, if you are operating a business, you are contributing your tax dollars to those particular funds. Those businesses that are operating in this community should not have such a hard time receiving the funding that they need so that they can be marketable, so they can be productive, hire the type of staff they need to hire, do the repairs to the building they need to do, paint, build, get better products, invest in your own. And I think you'll start to see, because everyone's talking about how special Miami is, I mean how special Overtown is, it's because somebody made it special before you stepped in here. So invest back in those people who did that. And that's
two things. Oh, it was four? You know me, that.
To address the question of what is missing or could be expanded, I just was thinking, what activities have I enjoyed in other areas that could possibly be brought here? A while ago, I took a cruise, and one of the stops was Key West. And one of the excursions was a bike tour. And it was so enjoyable. It had a very informative tour guide, and we went in and out of different areas. Most of you are aware of what's there in Key West, you know, Hemingway's place, and all around. And on top of the exercise, it was just such a wonderful cultural experience. It would be great if it could be mapped out and planned for the Overtown area.
One of the best experiences I think in Overtown is so awesome. It's grown over the last several years, and this past year I think was one of the best experiences. It had venues that accommodated all different types of folks. We had so many varied experiences from youth to very great national and international recognized art, great talk back series. So I think that's great. And what made that great is because there's a lot of local actors involved in the community who really plan all year for that particular event, so it's on everybody's agenda. And I think if we develop more of those community galvanizing events throughout the year that people plan for and they invest time and they invest resources, then those are things that can make Overtown real.
Earlier you mentioned, I think you said the Ebenezer Church, is that right? To expound upon that, I think what's missing when Miami is marketed, it comes over in character. So you said it, but I didn't feel it. And I think what's missing is, what does Miami know for characters? When you travel the country, colorful, colorful characters. You're sitting down here and you heard like three police sirens, right? I think it sounds good, what we're saying, but I think experience, are you familiar with the Suriname? Okay. The history of Overtown, the Suriname was where black entertainers would have to, they couldn't sleep on the beach, they'd have to perform over here. So you have this rich history of characters, right? One of those characters coming alive. Why isn't there a musical with Sammy Davis Jr. and Billie Holiday? And it's a mock Suriname, where basically, you're creating an experience where it's real. Mm-hmm. It's just kids out there, you heard the police sirens. Now they're saying, wow, Sammy, a legend was here on this block. So now the community is engaged and a part of the story. And you're selling it, you're not selling the story, you're living the story, you're respecting the story. And I think experiences are more real and authentic. That's engaging people out here. They're going to understand their history. And when you say tourism, right? You market a place, but we always, it's like the Caribbean, the exotic side, the beaches, the places, but the people don't matter. What makes tourists, what makes people really come to a place?
Local.
The people.
That's right.
Yeah. I just love, man, those people are great. They're amazing. But they got to be engaged. You were sitting on the police line. Somebody probably got shot. I'll be honest. So, but Saturday, June is here. Billy Holiday is here. If we're traveling this block, why is there a miracle? Why are there street performers acting these characters? And these people out there can be a part of that.
Before we go further, I want you to know that we had that discussion just 2 hours ago when Dr. Dorothy Fields said the same thing. 20th century characters from the early 1900s dressed up doing actual tours. So you read her mind, or you know, great minds think alike, as they say. Okay. Oh, ladies first. Thank you, Mr. Scott. Let the lady go first.
Good evening again. I think, and all of us who are involved in tourism and in just marketing my own, we know as travelers as well that it's consistency. If I visit New Orleans and I eat in a restaurant, I would feel that next year I'm going to go and I'm going to eat at that same restaurant, I'm going to have that same experience. If I go to a great show in New York, I want to go back a year later and experience again with a friend or a family member. I think many of the small organizations that are producing activities here in Miami, some of the great festivals, some of the weekly or monthly events, lack that consistency so that the tourists can't depend on it. I got off the ship last year in May. I always take a trip with my family every May. I came again. That show isn't happening again. And the reasons are long and varied, lack of funding, so on and so forth. So I would love to see what's missing or expanded is I would love to see some revenue or funds set aside to help some of the great events. Not all of our events are spectacular, but the ones that are really good, that are bringing in great audiences, and that are consistent and providing a wonderful depiction of Miami, for some funding to be provided so that there can be some consistency. Because even in this space, what's your great show again? Sweet Butter. It's a great show. It should be here consistently. The event I produce in LA should be consistent. If we can have some consistency with these events, I think it will attract tourists, and they'll see a reason to come to our neighborhoods because they know they'll always get something great when they come.
The question number two is a very profound question, especially in time we live in. As a present time, there's a project going on in Little Town called the 395 expansion. So part of the 395 expansion is going to bring a lot of change to Little Town. The underpassage of the bridgework is going to have a huge public space associated with it. And one of the things that I started discussing in this room about 3 months ago with project managers was literally the artistic enhancement of that project to reflect the history of Overtown. And literally, as I speak with you, we just finished up the last public meeting on that on last week, Thursday, at Miami Beach. And we're looking to put a huge mural underneath that bridge that has faced a variety of different community and public things that reflect Overtown heritage. We're looking to do contracting for those designs that are going forward. We have a partnership with the city manager to sign upon. And before I started, we've tried to speak with Commissioner Russell on this issue. And we then we had together in an event we were at. And I want you to understand that the thing that's really missing over time right now is infrastructure. Infrastructure in the past, such as nightclubs, such as the restaurants, such as the supermarket. There's not one decent supermarket in town. There's nothing here, substance that would attract someone to come inside other than drive from a big bus to city into Overtown. We have a lot of historic monuments here that no one catches and put into some powerful to say, come to see the women of Overtown experience, such as the historic monuments, the churches, the different houses that still remain. And yet, at the same time, there's a major planning effort and a change going on to create walking paths from Biscayne Boulevard all the Third Avenue, also to connect Little Haiti to Midtown and the Design Center, and coming through Ripley and going north into Overtown. When the 395 bridge is finished just down the street here, everyone, anyone who knows about the project will tell you, life in Overtown will not be the same again. That's a fact. And the folk locally who should have input to it also have been growing it. Even for employment opportunities, business opportunities, it's an $890 million project. And it's going to change over time. It has also a number of opportunities associated with it to enhance the culture and history over time. And I will tell you, as they come around trying to get more input from you and encourage not just the residents of the town, but the people South Florida as a whole participating in the process. Less than 4 months ago, when this project was about to jump off, there were over 300 people living under the bridge. And less than a week was cleaned out. I said the ceremony. No, we took them from under the bridge. There were mostly a lot of addicts. I took them from under the bridge. They're gone. I will tell anyone, if you want to commit a crime, it can be done anywhere in this entire country. If there's a desire, politicians, or people who want it to done, to do it. Remember Biscayne Boulevard 15 years ago? No one used an address. Maybe 10 years ago, no one used an address. Today, they're to destination, am I correct? We can actually change this particular destination to make it a very desirable one. All this can take is participation, cooperation, and determination to make happen. We just design what we want, literally, and the opportunity right now. We're talking spending hundreds of millions of dollars, and it can enhance in many more ways than you can imagine. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm going to give one more comment here to this fellow, and then we're going to move to question three.
You know, there's such thing as preparation. What we have in Overtown is really a grind. You think of places like New Orleans or Harlem, we've got a unique ability to coordinate with the Greater Miami CBD, and Bill, congratulate you and the team for being here. This is the first time we've had such a forum in Overtown. Am I correct? So it's always a beginning for all the businesses, and I can tell you because my parents had a business in this area for some 20 or 30 years, and the stay the course, and today it's going through an evolution. So when you look at tourism, the beauty is that I just looked at $266,488,188. Just imagine a portion of that. And what tourism does is preparation. For those of you that are in business, you've got to really look at the resources that are available. We all need more funding. I need another $30 million to buy more hotels. But at the end of the day, we've got to make sure that we work with the stakeholders that have an interest in developing Overtown, so that when the Overtown, the overpass is developed, I mean, imagine, this is my first time here in this church. I should have come when it was a church. I would have done a lot more good. But think about the evolution, Sweet Buttercup. So we have an opportunity as tourists come, so that I'm with the Port of Miami a couple times a month, talking with folks about the numbers of people that goes out of that port, that if we can stop and begin to develop the real programs, and we will. You're right, there may be nothing now to come. There's a Josephine Dunn Hotel down the street. There's a Copper Door two blocks away. There's a Lyric Theater. 10 years ago, and I know Bill needs me to say this, 15 years ago I came to Overtown, I allowed the SWAT team to bring me in. That is changing. So we have an opportunity to take this canvas and make it a real community where everybody can benefit. We're 4 or 5 blocks from Biscayne Boulevard. There's going to be a Marriott Marquis, 1800 homes down the street. So this is just part of a structure, an infrastructure, that it's time that we open our eyes and say, what do we put here? How do we develop the Jackson's Hole Pool? I mean, we're bidding on a piece of property to put a larger hotel in this market. 15 years ago, I wouldn't have thought about it. But I know that 10 years from now, what we do here today will determine how successful we are and this community becomes. Thanks.
I said I'm going to give one more, but
please forgive me, I must make a statement very profound than you just said. When this bridge is completed, there's an arch, six-level arch to be included in the bridge, and it will become the signature picture of Miami. Most of the pyramid arch is 300 something feet above the highway as you pass in the center of the town. So when you see that the arch is in St. Louis, Missouri, we're going to have one here about the same height, except be wider. Six arches with lights on it. That's been here over time. So when you see the football comes to mind, the heat gains, this is going to be the signature piece to demonstrate mine. No longer the power share only. It's this big bridge.
What I wanted to say, and respectfully I say this to Nicole, and I know your concerns, and I know your angst when we talk about businesses from out of town coming into our community. But when you think of development, you think of anchors that help draw businesses into a particular